as many innovations and audacity as reported, the 18th century is certainly a great century, especially in terms of ideas. However, history as taught to us today doesn't necessarily say much about the role of Africans in this regard. Hence the question, have Africans played a role in this century full of upheavals? The answer is yes. And to illustrate this answer, the Sankofa will embark you with two passengers during this week. Thanks to the works of African historians such as Dieudonné Yamaku and Yoporeka Sommet, let's discover the life and work of the first of these two pioneers, Anton Willem Amo, self-proclaimed the African from Guinea.
African History Daily by my daddy.
Born around 1700 in Aksim in the Nzima country, in the Akan ethnic group from southwestern of the present Ghana, the young Emo was about 3 years old when he was taken to the Netherlands with his brother Atta, probably after being captured, although the hypothesis of a departure in agreement with his parents was evoked by certain historians. Whatever the process through which he left Ghana, the young Amo was very quickly offered as a gift by the Dutch West India Company to the Dukes of Wolfenbüttel in Germany. His twin Atta was less lucky and was sent to Suriname to work as a slave. In 1708, the young Emo was christened Willem Anton after his two protectors' name, August Willem and Anton Ulrich. The official social status of Emo is not known with certainty, but he didn't work for his owners as one might expect. He began his studies at the University of Halle in 1727 and obtained a master's degree in law dealing with the issue of black people's rights in Europe, where he adopted anti-slavery positions. This piece of work marked a real interest for the cause of the black people, interest reinforced by the signature Emo adopted in Latin, Antonius Guillemus Emo, Guinea Affair, which means Willem Emo, the African from Guinea. He continued his studies in 1730 at the University of Wittenberg, where he defended 4 years later a doctoral thesis entitled The Inaugural Dissertation of Philosophy on the Apathy of the Human Mind, on the Lack of Sensation in Human Spirit, and its presence in the living and organic body. He then became the first person of African descent to obtain a doctorate of philosophy in Europe. He taught for 2 years in Wittenberg and then in Halle from 1736 to 1739. He also published a work entitled Treatise on the Art of Philosophy, Soberly and Correctly. Emo joined the University of Jena and was granted the title of state counselor by the Berlin court, probably with Frederick the Great. During his entire German university career, Emo studied philosophy and law, theology, logic, astronomy, astrology, political science, and physiology, and learned several languages, including Latin, Greek, Hebrew, German, and Dutch. However, as brilliant a thinker as he was, Emo had serious financial difficulties, aggravated by the death of his sponsor, the Prince of Brunswick, and his friends' professors, Hoffmann and von Ludwig. It is likely that Emo felt at that time the walls of his world closing on him, both socially and economically. Is that what made him decide to leave Germany? We do not know exactly why, but it is certain that he left Germany around 1747, for his hometown of Aksim in Ghana, where he found his father and his sister. The details of his life in Ghana are little known, although, according to David Henry Galender, who would have met him in 1753 in Aksim in Ghana, Emo was likely sent by force to the castle of slaveholders in Chama, since the settlers, fearing that his ideas on the condition of black people would negatively influence his community, who considered him as a wise man. Emo found death in 1758, leaving to posterity an important piece of work, certainly, but which was completely ignored by other German intellectuals at his university in Jena, such as Schiller, Fichte, Schelling and Hegel. It was only thanks to the perseverance and influence of President Kwame Nkrumah and William Abraham in the 1960s that German institutions began to recognize his figure and erudition. He is now celebrated by the two statues of an African couple at the University of Halle. My African cliché of the day is a motto, Amos' personal motto, which I quote, "Who can accommodate himself to necessity is wise and has an inkling of things divine." This motto, accompanying the signature of Emo, affixed on May 5, 1740, in an album of his friend Gottfried Achenwald of Elbing, inventor of statistics in Germany. This is also the last document bearing Emo's handwriting, which has so far come to light. And before you leave, let me ask you a question that is bothering me. Knowing that Emo had left Ghana at a very young age, in which language was he communicating with his family upon his return to Ghana? That must have been such a struggle. And on that note, thank you very much and goodbye.
If you like this podcast, don't forget to subscribe and post a comment on Apple Store or your usual podcast platform.